Hello friends, welcome back to All About Structural Analysis and Design. So in my previous RCC videos, we have seen the analysis of singly reinforced beam, doubly reinforced beam, and also I have shown you the design of singly reinforced beam for a simply supported case. So in this today's video, we shall see the design of RCC isolated footing of uniform thickness. Okay, so in this problem, they have given a design a isolated footing of uniform thickness of a RC column bearing a vertical load of 600 kilonewton. So from the load, this one, from the column, the load is coming onto that footing is 600 kilonewton and having a size of 500 mm into 500 mm. The column is a square column having a size of 500 mm into 500 mm. The safe bearing capacity of soil, okay, the SBC of soil is given as 120 kilonewton per meter square, and they have said to use the M20 and Fe415 materials, that is FCK is 20 and FY is 415. So steps involved are as follows. Okay, so there are six steps, okay, to complete a design of RCC footing. So first thing is you have to determine the size of footing, then find out the upward pressure P0, upward pressure in the sense pressure from the soil coming onto that particular footing from the base, then depth of footing on the basis of bending moment. With the help of that particular moment, you have to find out the depth. Then you have to go for area of reinforcement. Then you have to check for one-way shear, that is also known as beam shear. And also you have to do check for two-way shear, that is also known as punching shear. So these two cases are new in this particular problem. Okay, so what is meant by one-way shear and two-way shear? I will show you the calculations and also how it comes with the help of diagram. Okay, so as a usual practice, we have to write down the given data. So the given data is, first of all, it is isolated footing, then the load is given as 600 kilonewton. I have given the notation as WL. Okay, that is, this is also known as superimposed load, that is 600 kilonewton coming from that particular column. Then column size, they have given a square column, that is 500 mm into 500 mm, and also SBC of soil, they have mentioned 120 kilonewton per meter square. Then FCK given is 20 newton per mm square, and FY is 415 newton per mm square. So these are the steps involved, and also this is the given data for this particular problem. Now we shall solve this particular design problem step by step. So the first step will be determining the size of footing. So to determine the size of footing, okay, so you have to assume some weight of the footing. So what standard weight you are going to assume? So standard weight we assume before starting any footing problem is 10% of the superimposed load. Okay, so you can write down like this. Step number one, determine the size of the footing. So determine the size of the footing will be the step one. And before that, okay, you have to assume self weight of the footing. So nowhere they have given the weight of the footing. So what we do is assume self weight of footing. Okay, you can write down in this particular format, assume self weight of footing equal to 10%. Equal to 10% of superimposed load. So whatever load is coming from that particular column, so you are going to assume that it is 10% of the superimposed load will be the self weight of the footing. So that I will mention here as WD. Okay, WD is equals to 10% of 600 kilonewton. Okay, this will be 0.1 into 600, that will be WD will be 60 kilonewton. So we are assuming 60 kilonewton as weight of the footing. Okay, so now total load W will be WL plus WD. So W equal to WL is nothing but 600 kilonewton plus WD is 60. So W will be 660 kilonewton. Okay. So this will be the total load coming onto that particular footing. Now we have to find out area of footing. So the required area of footing is, So area A is equals to W divided by SBC. Okay. So area is equals to W divided by SBC. W is total load. Total load divided by SBC, if you do, you will be getting the total area of the footing. So it will be 660. SBC is in kilonewton per meter square. So no need to convert this again W into newton. So directly you can substitute 120. And it comes out to be, therefore, A is equals to 5.5. meter square. So this is the total area of the particular isolated footing. Okay. And in this case, we are designing a square footing. So therefore, we will be designing this particular problem of isolated footing as a square footing. Now, for square footing, okay, we are designing it as a square footing. B is nothing but the dimensions of the footing. B is equals to root of A, which is nothing but root of 5.5. Okay. So this B comes out to be, therefore, B is equals to 2.345 meters. Okay. So therefore, so you can make a just a box for this one also. Then therefore, provide, this sentence is very important. Provide a square footing of size, provide a square footing of size 2.4 meter into 2.4 meter. So now you have got the actual size of the footing. First, you have assumed the self weight of the footing as 10% of superimposed load and you have calculated WD. Then you are finding out total load, that is 600 plus 60, that is superimposed load plus load of the footing. Okay, you will be getting the total load. Then you are finding out the area of the footing. How? That is, area is equals to total load divided by SBC. And then after that, you are going to find out the side of the footing. By assuming it as a square footing, you are finding out B is equals to square root of A, and square root of A comes out to be 2.345, and we have rounded off to the next higher number, that is 2.4 meters. So therefore, we are providing a square footing of size 2.4 meter into 2.4 meter. So this concludes the step one of this particular design of footing. Then the next step is to find out the net upward pressure. So the step two for this design problem, step two to find out net upward pressure. Net upward pressure, which is denoted as P naught. Okay. So P naught is given by the formula W by B square. Okay. That is nothing but W divided by B into B. So W is total 660 divided by B. Now just now we have calculated, that is 2.4 into 2.4. So the P naught comes out to be 114, that is 114.58 kilonewton per meter square. So this is the total pressure which is coming onto that footing from the base. Okay, suppose this is your a square footing. Okay, then the whatever the pressure is coming from the soil, like this, it is denoted as P naught. Okay, so you have calculated now the second step of this particular problem, that is to find out the net upward pressure, which is denoted as P naught. P naught is calculated by W by B square, total load divided by the size of the footing. 660 divided by 2.4 square, you will be getting the net upward pressure P naught equal to 114.58 kilonewton per meter square. So this concludes your step two. Now the third step, which is very important in this particular design, is step 3 is all about finding out the depth on the basis of bending moment. Okay, so depth of footing on the basis of bending moment, on the basis of bending moment. So for this you need to have the little bit idea about the strength of materials for a cantilever beam, and this is perfectly explained by this particular figure. Okay, so there are three figures. Critical section for bending moment is the first figure, then critical section for beam shear, well, that is one way shear. Okay, check for one way shear we have to do, then we have to follow this figure, and check for two way shear, that is also known as punching shear, we have to follow this third figure. Okay, before seeing this figure, okay, we have to write down or we have to understand how to find out the maximum bending moment. The maximum bending moment acts, this is very important, acts at the face of the column, acts at the face of the column, and is given by the formula M equal to P naught B by 8 B minus small b the whole square. P naught is net upward pressure, B is the size of the footing, and this small b is the column size. Okay, so this you have to remember. Then just come back to this particular first figure. Okay, whatever you are seeing here, the first figure, okay, the plan of the figure and this footing I have drawn. Okay, this is your effective depth, the small d is effective depth, the column size is b small b, and the overall size of the footing, okay, is b into b. Okay, this is a square footing, so this side is also b and this side is also b, and in the center this is the column of size small b. And what it says, the maximum bending moment at the face of the column, the maximum bending moment is at the face of the column. This face can be either right hand side or the left hand side. So in this particular problem I have taken right hand side, and whatever the shaded portion you are seeing with the red color, okay, at a distance half b minus b is the distance which is having the maximum bending moment from the face of the column. Okay, so this particular thing is b by 2, this is b by 2, and again this b small b is divided into 2, that's why the formula becomes half into b minus b. So this is the critical section for the bending moment. For this particular distance at this section, at critical section, you need to calculate the bending moment, and with that bending moment you are required to find out the depth of the footing. Okay, so this is how you have to understand the first critical section for bending moment. Okay, so the bending moment acts at the face of the column, and it is given as M is equals to P naught B by 8 B minus B square. So some of you have a doubt how it came B minus B by 8. Actually, if you see, so just I will tell how it came P naught B by 8. Okay, so if you have seen your strength of materials, so the cantilever beam, okay, which is having a UDL, W per meter, acting at a length L. Okay, so the bending moment is W L square by 2. Okay, so now in this case what happens, so this is your footing. Okay, so you need to have the distance for this particular section. So the distance is half B minus B, as I have shown in the figure. Okay, then the load comes like this. Okay, this is P naught into B. Why I'm taking P naught into B is why, because this is kilonewton per meter square, and this is B is meter. Okay, so this meter and this meter will get cancelled, and the load will be kilonewton per meter. So that's why it came P naught into B, and this is half B minus B. Now what happens when you are finding out the bending moment equation or bending moment formula? So you are taking suppose a section here, okay, this one has XX and this is your section and this is your P naught B W, okay, acting at a distance of X. At X equal to now half B minus B. Okay, so this is your L. Don't get confused again. What is this at X equal to half B minus B? This is your L. Okay, so the equation becomes, bending moment equation becomes P naught B into X into X by 2. This is nothing but P naught B X square by 2. Now you have to replace this X with the amount, the distance half B minus B. Then the bending moment equation becomes P naught into B. X is nothing but half B minus B. And this half into X. X is nothing but again half B minus B. Okay, so this is a little bit confusing, but remember it is a type of a cantilever beam and we are getting the bending moment equation. So the standard bending moment equation for cantilever beam is WL square by 2. Okay, so this W is nothing but P naught B. So why we have taken P naught B, that also I have told in this calculation. So P naught B into X. So this X value is half B minus B into X by 2. Half I have taken aside and into half B minus B. So this total entire equation becomes 2 into 2, 4, 4 ones are 4, 4 twos are 8. So P naught, this B divided by 8, B minus B the whole square. So this is the equation we are following. Okay, I hope now this is clear how this P naught B by 8 B minus B the whole square came. So this is just a cantilever beam we have taken and we have simplified it. Okay, so this is how this M will come. This is M is equals to P naught B by 8 B minus B the whole square. I hope this calculation is clear. Now you have to just substitute and get the answer. So M is equals to P naught is 114.58 kilonewton per meter square. Everything will substitute in meter and kilonewton so that we will get the moment in kilonewton meter. So 114.58 into B is 2.4 in meters, 8, 2.4 minus 0.5. The column size they have given is 0.5 and we have to write here square. So M will be, M comes out to be 124.1 kilonewton meter. 124.1 kilonewton meter. So this is the moment acting at the face of the column. So this is the maximum bending moment acting at the face of the column. So this is just a moment. This is not the ultimate moment. For getting the ultimate moment, you need to multiply by factor of safety 1.5. So now ultimate moment that is nothing but mu equal to 1.5 into m. So mu equal to 1.5 into 124.1. So this comes out to be mu equals to 186.15 kilonewton meter. 186.15 kilonewton meter. So this is how you calculate the ultimate bending moment from the face of the column to determine the depth of the footing. Okay, remember the maximum bending moment lies at the face of the column, and the face of the column you have to find out the distance first and consider it as a cantilever beam, and with respect to the cantilever beam you have to find out the bending moment equation, substitute all the values and get the moment, and then go for ultimate moment by multiplying the factor of safety 1.5 and get the ultimate moment. Okay, so this is how the procedure to find out the moment. Now what you have to do, you have to find out the depth of the footing. So now D required D required. Okay, so D required, again if you remember page number 96, you have to go to page number 96. So see the C formula, MU limit formula, and find out the XU max by D. For Fe415 it is 0.48, and after substituting the XU max value here, you will be getting mu is equals to 0.138 FCK BD square. So mu equal to 0.138 FCK BD square. Okay, so in this case, this B will be capital B because we are taking the size of the footing. So mu, you know, okay, just you have to find out the D. So D square equals to mu divided by 0.138 FCK B. Okay, so therefore D equals to square root of mu divided by 0.138 FCK B. Okay, now just substitute the values. D is equals to square root of mu is 186.15 into 10 raised to 6. Why we are converting it into Newton millimeter? Because this FCK given is in Newton per mm square. So that's why we will be calculating this small d or effective depth in millimeters. Okay, so divided by 0.138, FCK is 20 and B is 2.4 meters, which is nothing but 2400 mm. Okay, so this B is D is equals to comes out to be 167.63 mm. Okay, which is approximately we will take D equal to 170 mm. Okay, then the minimum cover for footing you have to provide is 50 mm. So provide 50 mm cover, that is D dash. Okay, so therefore total D becomes 170 plus 50, which comes out to be D equal to 220 mm. So but remember, we are not taking this as the overall depth, okay, because the shear calculations have to be satisfied. So we will be doing the shear calculations now, and with the experience, okay, it is advisable to take the total depth little bit higher compared to how much you get with respect to this particular bending moment, okay, because of shear considerations. Otherwise your check for one way shear and check for two way shear will not satisfy if you take this D, okay, that is 170 mm, and do the calculations. That also I will show how it fails if you take only 170 mm. So due to shear considerations, okay, so I will write here one sentence. Due to shear considerations, okay, adopt higher effective depth. Therefore, adopt 400 mm as effective depth, that is small d, okay, and provide 50 mm cover. So we will keep the nominal cover, okay. Remember, this 50 mm is the minimum depth you have to provide, minimum effective cover depth, okay. Below that you cannot provide. You can provide 60 mm, 65, 70 mm, no problem, but minimum you have to provide is 50 mm. So therefore, D taken, okay, we will mention D taken is equals to 400 mm. Okay, therefore overall D becomes 400 plus 50. Therefore D is equals to 450 mm. So this is how you come to the conclusion of effective depth or overall depth. So whatever depth you are getting with respect to the moment will not be sufficient for the shear considerations. That's why due to shear considerations we are adopting a higher effective depth to satisfy the one way shear and two way shear. Now you have to go to step number 4, that is to determine the area of reinforcement. So this will be the usual method, Okay, fine. Taking the formula 0.5 CK by FY, that formula you have to take it and you have to find out the area of reinforcement. So step 4 will be, step 4, area of reinforcement. How much area of reinforcement is required, that you have to calculate. Okay, area of reinforcement. Okay, area of reinforcement. So usual formula you have to take it, that is AST equals to 0.5 FCK by FY, 0.5 FCK by FY, 1 minus root of 1 minus 4.6 mu FCK capital B D square into BD. Okay, so AST will be, just substitute now, 0.5 into 20 divided by 415, 1 minus root of 1 minus 4.6 mu was 186.15 into 10 raised to 6. Remember, we are substituting everything in Newton and millimeter. So FCK is 20, B is 2400 into D is how much we have taken the new, or what you can say, the higher effective depth. Higher effective depth, how much we have taken? 400 mm. So 400 square into 2400 into 400. So AST will be, after calculating this 1327, that is 1327.7 mm square. So this will be your AST. So this will be the total AST required for that particular moment and effective depth. Now you have to find out the percentage of reinforcement, that is P. So P is nothing but AST by BD into 100. Okay, so this will be 1327.7 divided by B is 2400 into D is 400 into 100. So P will be 0.138%. So remember, the minimum reinforcement you required for footing is 0.12 of gross area. So the norms are applicable, which is same for footing as well as slabs. Slabs also, minimum reinforcement for Fe415 or HYSD bars is 0.12 of gross area, and if you are providing with mild steel, it is 0.15 of gross area. So the for this footing, it is 0.12%. So it satisfies. So if it, so now you are getting 0.138, the minimum was 0.12, therefore it satisfies. It satisfies minimum reinforcement criteria. Minimum reinforcement criteria. That is 0.12%. Therefore, okay, you can say. Okay. Then what you have to do? You have to select one diameter for the reinforcing bars. Okay. So in this problem, I will be taking 12 mm bars using 12 mm 5 bars. 12 mm diameter bars in both the directions. Okay, in both the directions the same diameter will be provided. So in both directions, now you can just find out the small AST. So small AST equals to pi by 4 into 12 square, so it will comes out to be 113 mm square. So therefore, number of bars, number of bars will be capital AST by small AST, that is 1327. Okay, 1327.7 divided by 113, which comes out to be 11 point something. Okay, so the next higher number we'll be taking, that is 12 bars. So provide 12 mm 5 bars. So you can just write down like this, provide. Provide 12 mm 5 bars, 12 number of bars uniformly in both the directions. Okay, now you have to find out the spacing if you want to find out, because you want to know the uniform distribution. Okay, so therefore the spacing, spacing will be B divided by number of bars B is 2400 divided by number of bars is 12. It comes out to be 200 mm center to center. So at each 200 mm center, you have to provide one bar and you have to make a mesh, a square mesh of size 2400 into 2400. Okay. So now the next step, which is very important to understand in this particular concept, is the check for one way shear. So you have to be careful while doing the check for one way shear, okay? Because both the shear has to be satisfied. If not satisfied, then you have to again increase the depth of the footing and you have to carry on the again, once again, the area of reinforcement and all, okay? So that's why we have taken the more or greater effective depth while calculating the effective depth, okay, on the basis of bending moment. So now the step five will be the check for one-way shear. Check for one-way shear. So for one-way shear, the critical section is located at a distance d from the face of the column. So we'll get back again to this three figures. Okay. So the first figure is over critical section for bending moment. Now the critical section for beam shear. Okay. So one-way shear is also known as beam shear, because we are considering it as beam and we are analyzing. And what it says for one-way shear, the critical section lies at a distance d from the face of the column. So this is the face of the column, okay? So this is the face of the column and it lies at a distance d from the face of the column. So this distance, whatever you are seeing, is the effective depth distance, and from that distance, this strip, whichever you are seeing in green color, is a beam shear section, okay? And the distance for this particular strip is half b minus d. You know, first of all, that this from a face of the column, it was half b minus b, okay? That half b minus b remains as it is, and also we have to minus this d in this particular distance. So the total distance of that strips becomes half b minus d, okay? So this is the critical section for beam shear, or also known as one way shear, okay? So you can write here one sentence that for one way shear, for one way shear, critical section is located, critical section is located at a distance d from the face of the column, at a distance d from the face of the column. Okay, so now you have to find out the shear force acting on that particular distance, okay, half b minus d, and you have to check that nominal shear stress and again the design shear strength for concrete, and you have to show it as safe, okay? Now shear force V is nothing but force into distance, not force into shear force is calculated in kilonewtons, okay? So this P naught B will come as it is, because this is W, and you have to multiply it by half B minus B, okay, minus D. So again, you will have a question. Why this again, this distance is coming? Because shear force means the distance will not come, force into distance. Because again, the same for this calculation. So this is P naught B, okay, correct? P naught B is nothing but kilonewton per meter square into meter. So this meter and this meter will get cancelled and it will become kilonewton per meter square, okay? So again, you are multiplying for that particular distance of strip in meters. So this meter and this meter will get cancelled and it will remain in kilonewton. So shear force will be in kilonewton. That's why we are again multiplying with that particular distance for that beam shear distance. Okay. So now again, just substitute here. Everything is known. So V is equals to 114.58. B is again 2.4, so we'll substitute in kilonewton and meter, okay? Half B is 2.4 minus 0.5, and minus D, how much you have taken is 400 mm, that is becomes 0.4. So this V or shear force comes out to be 151.24 kilonewton. Okay, so the shear force will come out to be 151.24 kilonewton. Remember, this is not again ultimate shear force. Okay, that's why again you have to multiply it by factor of safety. So, and then ultimate shear force VU. So VU is equals to 1.5 into V. So 1.5 into 151.24. So VU becomes 226.86 kilonewton. So VU is equals to 226.86 kilonewton. So this is your ultimate shear force for the one-way shear. Now, as usual, you have to find out the nominal shear stress, and that is VU by VD. Okay. So now, nominal shear stress tau V. Nominal shear stress tau V. Okay, so tau V is given by VU by BD. Okay, so again, this has came from page number 96, not page number 96, from IS 456 2000, I think page number 72 of IS 456. Okay, page 72 of IS 456 2000. Okay, so just substitute now VU. VU is now, just now we have got 226.86 into 10 raised to 3, or yes, we are calculating in Newton per mm square. This becomes 2400, D is 400. So tau V comes out to be 0.236 Newton per mm square, 0.236 Newton per mm square. So this is your nominal shear stress. Okay, then now for solid slab. Okay, so if you go to page number 72 again, so for solid slabs, the design shear strength for concrete shall be tau C K, where K has the given values below. So overall depth of slab is given. So footing will be considered as a solid slab, and we will be finding out the design shear strength of concrete, remember. Okay, so it is given as tau C K. So design shear strength of concrete. Now design shear strength of concrete okay, tau C dash, we can just make it all. Tau C dash equal be K into tau C into K. Okay, and this K is from this again page number 72 IS 456 2000. Okay, will be considered as a, it will be considered as a solid slab. Okay, this is again page number 72. Okay, yes, page number 72, and this K value will be taking, and our overall depth of slab is 450 mm, so directly K will be taken as 1, because 300 or more, if it the depth is there, then directly 1 we will be taking and multiplying with the tau C. Okay, and K is equals to 1. Okay, because depth is more than 300 mm, and tau C for 0.138% of steel. Okay, we are using again this from page number 73. This table number 19 to find out design shear strength of concrete. This is tau C. So the P we have calculated 0.138, and it is less than 0.15, so directly we can take it as 0.28. So M20 is having 0.28. okay, so then tau C will be, therefore tau C will be 0.28 Newton per mm square. So now tau V is less than tau C. Okay, therefore, okay, So if you take this particular k tau c, okay, so this is tau v. Tau v is nothing but I will show you that depth, whatever we have calculated on the basis of moment, was less, and it would have failed if you have taken 170 mm. So I will show you. So tau v is nothing but vu by bd, okay. We will equate it to k into tau c, okay. So this is tau c dash, okay. So this is k into tau c. So from this, d is unknown, or we will find out d, okay. So d will be b, so d will go to this side, and it will become vu by bk tau c, okay. So vu is again same 226.86 into 10 raised to 3 divided by b is 2400, okay, and k is 1, and this is 0.28. so this d comes out to be, okay, 337 mm, okay, which is greater than d equals to 170 on the basis of moment, on the basis of moment we had calculated. So if you have taken 170 and if you have done here the calculations, so it would have failed in one way shear. So that's why we have increased this d to 400 mm, and that 400 mm is greater than this 337 mm. Therefore d provided, okay, d provided is equals to 400 mm, which is greater than 337 mm. Therefore okay, or satisfied in one way shear. Therefore okay in one way shear. So this is how you show the one way shear check for one way shear. So that's why we increase the effective depth while calculating the original effective depth. We slightly increase the effective depth. So now the last step of this particular problem is check for two-way shear. So you have to perform now check for two-way shear, and that concludes your problem. So step number 6, okay, check for two-way shear. Step 6, check for two-way shear. So two-way shear is also known as punching shear. Okay, so for to understand this, you have to come again to this third figure. So this is the third figure, is for a critical section for punching shear or two-way shear. So what it says, for two-way shear or punching shear, the section lies at a distance d by 2 from the column face all around. So this is your column, which is having a dimensions b, and the section lies at a distance d by 2 from all the face of the column. So thus the dotted line, the dotted brown line which you are seeing all around the column, is having a distance of d by 2. So from this face to this dotted line, the distance is d by 2, and from this face to this dotted line is again d by 2. Similarly for this upper and downward line also. So the b naught, or the perimeter of that particular dotted line, becomes b naught is equals to b plus d. So this is already b plus d by 2 plus d by 2, it becomes d. So b naught is equals to b plus d, and this also becomes b naught is equals to b plus d. So why we call it as punching shear also, because this is with respect to the column, and column is creating a type of punch on this particular footing, and it will tear off in a shear. So that's why we call it as a punching shear or two-way shear. Two-way shear is nothing but from all the sides of that particular column, it is having a punch, and that's why it is known as a punching shear. Okay, so remember, or I will write down this sentence again. For two-way shear, also known as punching shear, the section lies at a distance d by 2 from the column face all around. Okay, so it will create a perimeter of B is equals to B naught is equals to B plus D. Therefore, the width becomes, which is denoted as B naught, B plus D. And substitute here, B is 500 mm, D is 400. Okay, so B naught becomes 900 mm. So you can just make a box for this B naught. And now the net shear force acting on the perimeter you have to take. Okay, now the net shear force acting on that particular perimeter. Okay, acting on the perimeter. So F we will be denoting it as, okay, so this P naught B square minus B naught square. So this is the formula to find out the shear force acting on that particular perimeter. F is equals to P naught B square minus B naught square. So this F is equals to P naught B square remains as it is, and this B naught is again B plus D. Okay, directly you can substitute 900, no problem. So F is equals to 114.58 kilonewton per meter square. B is 2.4 square minus this 0.9 the whole square. So F comes out to be 561.171 kilonewton. Okay, and the ultimate shear force by multiplying factor of safety 1.5, that comes out to be, therefore Fu comes out to be, after multiplying, that is 841.75 kilonewton. So this is your ultimate shear force for two-way shear. So now again I will show you one of the page of IS456, that is page number 57. Okay, so page 57 you have to go. Okay, and already they have mentioned here, okay, for solid slabs, if you are getting confused, okay, so this will be the shear calculation of shear stress for solid slabs, page number 57. So I'm just tilting here, okay, because I'm not able to share this, show this completely in a straight manner. So the nominal shear stress in flat slabs, remember this footing will be treated as a slab and will be designing, shall be taken as V by B naught D, where V is the shear force due to design load and B naught is the periphery of the critical section and D is the effective depth. Okay, so that particular you have to see here, page number 57, and you have to do it. Okay, and this has been mentioned in page number 65. So I'll show that page number 65 also here. And you can see here from 34.2.4, what they have mentioned, two-way action of the footing with potential diagonal cracking along the surface of truncated cone or pyramid around the concentrated load. In this case, the footing shall be designed for shear in accordance with the appropriate provision specified in 31.6. So whatever page number I had opened, page number 57, it is for that two-way shear. Okay, then you can write here from page number 57, from page 57, 31.6.2, tau V equal to Fu by 4 B naught D. 4 is nothing but the 4 times, okay, B naught. Then 841.75 into 10 raised to 3, substitute in Newton, okay, then 4 times 900 into 400. So this comes out to be 0.58 Newton per mm square. Okay, so now permissible shear stress. Now permissible shear stress, okay, so Ks tau c. So again it is given in page number 58, you have to go back to page number 58 of IS456-2000. Okay, here they have mentioned permissible shear stress, and the shear reinforcement is not provided, the calculated shear stress at the critical section shall not exceed Ks tau c. So this permissible shear stress is Ks tau c. Then again this calculations they have given. So Ks is equals to 0.5 beta c. So it should not be greater than 1, and beta c being the ratio of short side to long side of the column. Here it is a square column, so the question will not arise of long side and short side. So automatically that beta c will be 1. And tau c we have to take 0.25 root of fck. Fck is 20, which is given in this particular problem. Okay, so this ks is equals to 0.5 beta c, 0.5 plus beta c. So this will be because square column, therefore 1. So ks will be 0.5 plus 1, which is equals to 1.5, but they have mentioned it should not be greater than 1, therefore ks equals to 1, which is maximum. Now tau c equals to 0.25 root of fck, which comes out to be again 0.25 root of 20. Okay, here it comes out to be 1.11 newton per mm square. Therefore ks tau c 1 into 1.11 will be again 1.11 newton per mm square. Therefore tau v is 0.58 and your ks tau c is 1.11, so tau v is less than ks tau c. Therefore safe in two-way shear. So this is how you have to show the checks for one-way shear and two-way shear. So I hope all the doubts, how that moment equation came, how the one-way shear should do, one two-way shear, how we should follow, I think all the steps are clear in this particular explanation. Okay, if you have any doubts, again you can just comment in the comment section, and I will be clarifying the doubts in the comment section. So if you have understood this video, please like the video, share the video, and don't forget to subscribe All About Structural Analysis and Design, and also press the bell icon for the latest notifications of my videos in civil and structural engineering. Thank you, friends.